It's Saturday, October 8th, 2016, and welcome to part one of Countdown to Retirement's monthly video journal, again for October. This video will be for October. In these videos, if you're new to the videos, not that anybody's watching, but if you happen to watch and you're new to the videos, every month I review what books I purchased, what books I read, and what movies I watched. Kind of just a way for me to count down to my retirement, which is now about 33 months away. So right now, this video, I'm just going to go over books that I bought today. Took a trip to Connecticut with my family and had a great time. And here's the books that I purchased. First is a paperback, Spectrum 2. A little bit of damage there on the front. Actually, there was a price sticker there, and I couldn't get it off. I don't know why they had to put the sticker right there in the middle with that big white space to either side, but it's okay. It's just a reading copy. It was only a dollar. So you can see here who's in it. Edited by Kingsley Amis, and Robert Conquest is the name that got messed up there. But I looked it up online. Has some good stories, some throwaways, but... you know, I'll read it, I'll judge for myself. Next book, many of you may remember Rod Serling's Night Gallery. So this is the second volume of stories. I think there were five stories in here. Again, a dollar. So it seemed like a nice thing to get. Maybe I'll read it, maybe not. It depends how much time I have in this life. I have so many books, I just don't know how I'm going to read them all, but I'm sure going to try. So let's see here, what's next? I have a Western by Robert Bell called Never Say Die. And nice cover. It's about, excuse the glare, it's about a white cowboy and an Apache woman who kind of team up to go after some desperados who ambush them, actually in two separate groups. They ambushed Apaches and they ambushed some cowboys, and the two survivors from each attack team up together. So look kind of interesting, and again, only a dollar, so pretty cool. Now this book here I have with a different cover. It's Cliff Farrell, Comanche. I'll see which one is better condition, and that'll be my reading, my copy to save, and the other one will be my reading copy. And got a cool cover. Then I found all three of the first three Foundation novels by Isaac Asimov. I've never read them. There's Isaac Asimov Foundation. Whoops. Let me get that. Foundation and Empire. And second Foundation. That's the third one. And then I think he added some more to the series afterwards, but I've never read any of them, so this is all new to me. It was kind of cool to get them because they're obviously part of the same series. And it was all three volumes, and they're all in great shape. Next, this book I have in hardcover. Now I have the paperback. Sign Talker by James Alexander Thom. It's a fictional account of George Drouillard, who was with Lewis and Clark. I won't read this and judge it too harshly on actual historical accuracy. I'll just, if I ever get to read it, just review it on how well it's, you know, how well the story is unto itself. Which I think is how you have to kind of read that kind of book. For those familiar with Taschen, they make very nice photo books, and this one's on Cary Grant. I like a lot of Cary Grant movies, and he seemed like a pretty cool guy. So, it's pretty nice. The Star Trek interview book. This I looked up online. It's by Alan Asherman. Has mixed reviews. Basically, some people didn't care for all the interviews, or, you know, but those people are maybe very heavily into Star Trek, and I'm not. although I did buy the book. But I'm not like a big Trekkie, so I was just flipping through it, and from what I was reading, it was just kind of interesting. It's easy reading, so I figured, what the hell. It was in nice shape. Next, War in the Golden Weather. It's a very weird name for a book. It's written by Stephen Longstreet, who also wrote some history books. This is the first book in, I think, a trilogy. It's a thick book, too. It's in excellent condition. It actually came with the clear jacket on it already to protect the dust jacket. Otherwise, I would have put one on myself. Looked it up online. Has very good reviews. And maybe I'll find the other two in the series. So, good find there. This book is takes place, I think, during the French and Indian War, and has a George Washington in it. But it's a fiction. Obviously, it's a fictional book. But like I just said, George Washington is in it, and I'm sure some other historical people. Let's see here. This one here, No Tears for the General: The Life of Alfred Sully, 1821 to 1879, by his grandson, Langdon Sully. So that's pretty cool. His grandson, from what I understand, had letters from his grandfather, and he used those to help write the book. There was some art in here. Let me see if I could find it. And I went past it. So, looks pretty good. There's some information on Custer in here, who Sully had dealings with, and basically some Indian Wars. I'm sure the Civil War is in here. Even the Mexican-American War is probably in here, too. Let's see. Next, Douglas C. Jones, Roman, a novel. This is the follow-up to Elkhorn Tavern, which I don't have. Maybe I'll get it. I've seen it around. I just never did get it because it's basically a Civil War novel, and I don't really read too much of that. But now that I have this book, this includes the Battle of Beecher's Island in 1868. And Douglas C. Jones is a pretty good author. So there you go. It was in great shape. Hardcover, dust jacket. So I picked that up. Next, The Horse in Blackfoot Indian Culture by John C. Ewers. I have this with a different cover in soft cover, which is what this book is. And I also have a hardcover version. So this is my third. It was $5. It's in excellent shape. And I felt it was worth the investment to get the other one. Plus, it had like a different cover. The End of the Myth. This is Time Life book. Many of you might recognize this series. It was pretty cool. It had this paper thing around it, like a kind of a, just around the bottom. I never saw them like that before. Kind of like an advertisement for the book. And this is basically the American West, how, after the Indian Wars, how it was portrayed and what happened to, I guess, a lot of the people from the Old West, Native Americans, how they joined up with Old West shows, and so it's kind of like the passing of an era. Now, this book here, I have mixed feelings about. I think it was $10, and it's in great shape. Thomas Males was a Christian minister, retired when he wrote this. And there's a lot of really nice illustrations in here. I mean, he did the one on the cover, so you could see he was a really good artist. And the book is just filled with black and white and color illustrations. But he allowed his Christianity to influence his writing in negatively. So, I mean, just I opened up this book to page 91, and right there he's saying how the Indians, the Native Americans, knew the Christian God, but they didn't know him correctly because they didn't know who Jesus was. I mean, that's, like, really disgusting to say. First of all, you know, I don't believe in Jesus. I don't believe in the Christian God. I don't believe there's any God. But just to write that, you know, first of all, how does he know that they believed in the same Christian God. Hey, he doesn't know that. And to say that, you know, the Indians, you know, knew God but didn't really know him correctly, I'm not quoting exactly the words, but that's the gist of what he said. He was saying that too bad for them, they didn't know Christianity. That's really smug and disgusting and terrible, and I don't know what else to say about it, but there's a lot of great art in here, and I figured I'd just get it. It's a thick book, and there might be some nice information in there. But when it comes to that part of his text on the Indians with the religion, I could see that's going to be an aggravating chapter to read. But I might do it just out of curiosity, just to see what he has to say. Maybe one day I'll write about that, how, you know, the Indians got a raw deal and talk about religion and how it was really forced upon them. But I'm not going to get into it anymore over here. To say the Indians became, I just said I'm not going to get into it, and here I am continuing. To say the Indians became Christians is really kind of unfair. I mean, they were beaten, defeated people. They were already spiritual. They believed in, not just, they believed in taking any kind of religious beliefs they can get from anywhere that would help them, you know, in the world. Hunting, war, love, anything. I mean, they were open to other ideas, not just their own. And of course, you know, when they lost the Indian Wars and they were on their reservations and they were hungry and weren't doing well, they were easy prey to the churches. There's a lot of stories there, you know, with the children not being allowed to speak their language, with the families being told they're not going to get food unless they go to church, all kinds of stuff. So it's not a pleasant history. I don't know if anybody's ever really even covered this very well, because it's a touchy subject. I can see, you know, them being afraid, you know, a writer being afraid to even cover this thoroughly, because it's kind of like a, you know, that would be a hot spot. I don't think the Christians would care too much for that kind of book. Okay, next, The Story of Leaning Tree. This is a profusely illustrated book also. The subtitle is Art and Enterprise in the American West. And let me see if I could open it up here. It's just really have all of... Leaning Tree is, of course, a greeting card company. I can't open it up as much as I want, so I got one hand doing it. But just really profusely illustrated. Looks like a really nice book. Essays by Don Hedgepeth and art, and it says, art commentary by Ed Trumbull. So this looks like a really good book. I think this was $12 and it's like brand new. The price on it is $75 originally, and it's just in excellent shape. So that's what I bought. That's the last one for this video. There you go. I'll give a little quick look around the room. It's a little bit dark. There you go. All those boxes have books. Boxes with books. Bookcases with books. books. Boxes with books. It's like a warehouse in here. Bookcase with books. Books. More books. So maybe one day I'll do a really good in-depth video of my collection. There's more in the bedroom. But that's it for now. Over and out. It's Saturday, October 15th, and today we went to the Brooklyn Public Library book sale, their annual book sale at Grand Army Plaza. It was a zoo. It started at 10 o'clock. We got there about 9:30, and they were setting up. It was just a mess. They didn't have it set up in time, and they kept bringing out more carts of books, but the books kept falling off the carts, and there were more people than books pretty much for most of the event. And people are just shoving to see what was on the carts, and
It's just a mess. But everything was a dollar. And I did pick up a few books, which I'm going to show right now. So I got this nice copy of The Big Sky, which I have other copies of, but it's a great book, and I don't mind getting duplicates. I like to have, one day I plan to have, you know, a bigger home, and I could put one copy in each room. Great book. Then I picked up the complete Edgar Allan Poe tales. This is leather. It's a piece of paper I put in there with some notes. But here, it's got a nice inside of the cover there. And it's all the tales, all the stories, not the poems, but just the stories. I actually looked this up on eBay when I got home, because again, it was only a dollar. And someone was selling it for $35, and another person had it for $99. And I got it for $1. Really excellent shape. Then I picked up 7 volumes to a series. There's 12 volumes total, as I found out when I got home and looked it up on the internet. These are volumes 1 through 7. They're hard to see the numbers, but there's number 1. So I got 1 through 7. They were a dollar each. And basically, this one is before 1775. I don't even think these were red because they're very crisp. This one here is 1775 to 1789. 1789 to 1829. 1829 to 1849. 1849 to 1865. This one's a little bit of a... even though the other one ended at 1865, this one goes back to 1861 up to 1876. And then I got 1860. Oh, I got two of those. One of them I already had. And then the last one that I picked up was 1877 to 1890. And again, these are pretty cool books. Lots of pictures, text. And a lot of them are very crisp. When you open them up, they're still stiff, so I don't think they've been read. And so that was it for today. It was fun. Talk to you next time. Bye-bye. It's Friday afternoon, October 21, 2016. Here's a quick little update for the month of October. This came in the mail today. James D. McLeod, Hugh Glass, Grizzly Survivor. He also wrote a book about Calamity Jane that I have. That one's hardcover. This is softcover. That came from Amazon. And these two I picked up at a used bookstore today. This book here, Frontier America, softcover. Excellent condition. Price $1. So you bet I took it. I have it in hardcover, but I'll put that one away and keep the softcover out. So it was a nice find. And this last one here, Charles M. Russell, Masterpieces from the Amon Carter Museum. And this has a nice selection of images by Russell with text by Rick Stewart. And this book has, oh, here's my favorite, I think this is my favorite piece of art of the American West, and it's by Charles Russell called The Medicine Man, as you can see over here. And this painting to me is just amazing. I absolutely love the Blackfoot leader there and his pony in front there. It's awesome. Now tomorrow we head out to a library book sale. So hopefully I'll have a lot of stuff to show tomorrow. We'll see. On the one hand, I'd like to find a lot of books. On the other hand, I have so many. I could do with finding not too many. Wouldn't be such a bad deal. But hope to have fun. Later.
Well, hello again. As I mentioned in my last video clip, today on Saturday, October 22nd, my family went to 2 bookstores. These are used bookstores, part of the libraries, and one of them was having a sale, half price. So I'm going to go over what I bought at both libraries. Most everything, I think I got 29 books here, and like 22 or 23 of them were purchased at the half price sale. All the books total came to $22, so I paid less than a dollar a book, and
And some of these are really good, as you'll see. Right now, I'm going to start with the paperbacks. These were 25 cents each, except for... No, I think all of these I bought at that first sale, and they were a quarter each. So, I'm sorry, give me a second here. Four Tarzan books, Jungle Tales of Tarzan, Tarzan and the Jewels of Opar, The Beasts of Tarzan, and The Son of Tarzan. I read the first Tarzan novel sometime in the... almost a year ago, more or less, maybe 2 years ago. I lose track of time. It was pretty good. I mean, you know, not... couldn't happen in real life. But it was a cool kind of partial fantasy story, and kept my interest. I thought Edgar Rice Burroughs was a very good author. I liked it, so I've been picking up, you know, other ones in the series as I see them. Usually I get the black cover ones. If you're familiar with the series, the ones that have black covers have some really nice art. These aren't too bad. It's an older series. But most of the ones I have are the black covers. But for a quarter each, this was a dollar, all four. Can't beat that, right? Other than free. Okay, then I've picked up Conagher by Louis L'Amour. And I actually purchased this because it has... Sam Elliott on the cover, and he's a pretty cool guy, like his voice, and of course that's Catherine Ross, who is his real life wife. Even though he only had a small part in The Big Lebowski, it was pretty memorable. So there you go, Sam Elliott on the cover, and it was like in brand new condition, so I picked it up. Then Under the Sweetwater Rim, Louis L'Amour. And this takes place in Wyoming, I believe, in the early 1860s. Looked interesting. A quarter. And this was pretty cool. The early Asimov book one, because in a previous video, I'm not sure if it was a previous video from a clip from this month or from Pat from last month, but I had purchased book two. And... I wonder if it was at the same store my last visit. I don't remember. But here I found Volume 1, so that was pretty cool. I didn't think I'd find that one, at least find it so quickly. So now I have Volumes 1 and 2. Terry Johnson, famous historical novelist of the American West. Mountain Men and Indian Wars related books. And this one is Wolf Mountain Moon, part of a series with a character named Seamus Dunnigan. I haven't read any of this series yet, but I have about 10 or so books from this series. So much to read, I just, you know, sorry, do my best. I did read three of his Mountain Man books. Did I read a fourth one? I don't remember. I know I read the original trilogy, starting with Carry the Wind, and I recommend those. Lonesome Dove, I have copies of this book, but it was a quarter, and it was like brand new. Spines not even broken. Corners were in great shape. 25 cents. Okay, I'll get it. I don't need it. But if I didn't get it for a quarter, I'd just feel bad the whole night. In like the next 10 years. The Fleet Rabble. This I have in hardcover, and I have another paperback like this one here. And, I tried to read this book a few years ago, and I didn't get past the first few chapters. It was, the writing was a bit different for me. I'm going to try it again. It seemed like, I mean, it was a challenge. Some authors just have a way of writing in a very challenging way. I'm going to give it another chance, and I really want to get through it. I don't want to stop again. I really do want to read the book and judge it. Let me fix the light here. Judge it, properly by reading the whole book. And it's got a cool cover. Okay, let's see here. This, Sun Chief, the autobiography of a Hopi Indian. This book was like brand new. Corners are nice. if it was read, it was read gently. The reason why I picked this up, first of all, it was 50 cents. That's not why I bought it, although that certainly helped. On the back, I was looking at it, and it tells how this Hopi Indian renounced, I guess he had kind of had Christianity pushed upon him by missionaries, and most of the Indians just, you know, converted. It was just easier. Even if they kept some of their own previous traditions and religious activity, they still converted. It was tough times, and they were already religious people. They did lose. They were down and out, and you push religion on them, a different one, and they're thinking like, well, you know, you're more powerful than me. Maybe your God is the reason why. There's many reasons why the Indians converted to Christianity. None of them really very honorable or positive towards Christianity, in my opinion. So anyway, this Hopi Indian Sun Chief, it says on the back here that he renounced Christianity and went back to his former worshiping and religious practices. That kind of sparked my interest. So I'm looking forward to reading this book and seeing what happened. I probably didn't express too well the reasons why the Indians became Christians, although I think that I did hit some of the points. Not too good off the cuff here. A lot of times I think about this stuff, and sometimes I even write down notes, but I'm not prepared for it right now, and that's the best I had. But that wasn't too bad. People who are already spiritual and believe in that kind of thing, and they're down and out in Beverly Hills, so to speak, they need something. Their religion obviously didn't work because they lost. They lost their land, they lost battles, they died from disease, and here comes other people saying, we have the real God, and, you have to stop what you're doing and do what we say. And it'd be persuasive, or you just want to go along with what the others are doing. Not that they always gave up their native religion entirely. They were very much for, adding new dimensions to what they believed. That was kind of unique about them, whereas, like the Abrahamic religions, it's believe as we say or go to hell kind of, if not literally, figuratively. Whereas Indians were after, power, harnessing power in the universe to help them in war and hunting and love and whatever they needed to do. So they were open to ideas of different gods, but didn't mean they had to renounce their own gods. It's like, you got another god. Oh, okay, bring it on in. I'll add it to the ones I've already got. But that wasn't how the Christian missionaries wanted it to be. It was like, you got to stop your language. You have to stop practicing your religion. Send your kids to our schools. We're going to wipe the Indian out of you and make you, quote-unquote, civilized. I'm getting off track here. Let me go back to the next book. But I would like to maybe make a video with all these different thoughts I have about religion and the universe, but who knows if I ever will. I would like to. I'll have to see how I feel, get my thoughts together. I just don't want to make a video and then, start getting all these comments, because I want to allow comments, not that anybody's even watching. But let's say someone came across it. I don't want to get into arguments and people writing just stupid things, and, it would be great, of course, if people agreed with me. that would feel good. But my experience with the internet is that you post something, you could write 1 + 1 = 2, and people will just come on and just attack you. It's just amazing. Things that just seem so obvious to me are just not obvious to others, and I could also be wrong sometimes. I'm not saying I'm not. Sometimes I think people just want to argue, and they have that what I call tough guy internet syndrome. They're very tough when they're typing to you. They would never talk to you that way, but they have a disagreement with you, and they're just like acting as if they're kicking your ass while they're typing. Just find that very odd. Okay, back to the books. So, Treasure Island, Robert Louis Stevenson. I have other copies of this book, but not
this particular kind. It's kind of cool. It's got like, it's soft cover, but it has, you fold it over, it's kind of like a, like this. So, it's a little bit, you know, it's sturdy. It's brand new. I don't think it's been read. It's got what they call decal edge. Like it's not even. The pages are all cut different. It's pretty cool. Nice cover. So, Treasure Island, there you go. Okay, so now I picked up, I had this book in hardcover, but it was 50 cents, so I thought I'll get the soft cover, that'll be my reading copy. It's called D. Brown, The American West. Again, 50 cents, it's in great shape. And then, what happened was I saw another D. Brown book. This is called The Settler's West, and this was 50 cents also. And what happened was I didn't realize it, and I would have bought it anyway, but this basically, our chapters dealing specifically with settlers that were excerpted from this book. So this is just like a mini version of this book with, this has less in it, because this is more inclusive of other topics, whereas this is just the settlers. I think it was eight chapters in here on like on settlers in the West. Okay, this I have, but it was a dollar, and it was like brand new, hardcover. I didn't say no. I'm like pathetic. I just, if they had 10 copies for a dollar, I probably would have bought 5 of them. I don't know. I don't know what's wrong with me. But there you go. Maybe one day I'll have a bookstore. I don't know. That'd be awesome. Which would be so awesome, but I don't know. There you go. Empire of the Sun Moon. Looking forward to reading that. Red Cloud. This I have in soft cover, and I actually, when I purchased it, I, in the back of my head, I thought I had it in hardcover too. When I got home, I realized I didn't, so it was a good purchase. Red Cloud by Robert W. Larson, hardcover. And it was like brand new, just sitting here on the shelf, $1. Okay, this I purchased mostly because it had a cool cover. When I got home and looked it up, it's got very bad reviews, so I might get rid of it. It's called Starship, The First Adventure by Vonder N. McIntyre. And this is supposed to be like the original voyage with Captain Kirk. And it had a cool cover. Let me open it up here. We like the cast. And the cover kind of sold me. I figured, look, if it's not good, it only cost me 50 cents. So what the hell? I'll try it. But, you know, again, it got a lot of bad reviews. Some people like it, but most people just trashed it. So I'm not sure if I'm going to keep it or not. I'll see. But in the meantime, I got it. Okay, 1 second there. Excuse me. Okay, now, it was raining a little bit today, and my wife went to get the car. And while she was getting the car, they were putting more books on the shelf. And, you know, I couldn't help but look. I wish I could stand there all day and just watch them putting books out and just grab them what I want as they were doing it. This was not at the half-price store, but it was still an amazing price. Edgar Allan Poe, Complete Tales and Poems. Look how thick. It's like brand new. $2. This has, you know, all the complete stories and poems. And it's got like a little introduction. $2. Pretty good. Okay, excuse me here. Oh, 1 second. Let me put this down over here. Okay, I'm running out of space. Now, this was pretty cool, this next one. This is the first one book I found when I went into the store. I went right to the art section. And this book I'm about to show you, I've seen it on the internet, and it just goes for, you know, enough money that I don't want to put out for it without seeing what's inside it. I never purchased it. And I never seen it in a used bookstore until today. The list price is $85. And this was the half-price store today, so it was normally hardcovers at $2 at this library store, so I got this book for $1, an $85 book, in like excellent condition. I got it for $1. So this is called Western Traditions, Contemporary Artists of the American West by Michael Duty and Suzanne Dietz. And this is just like lots of art in it. Howard Turpning and others. Names escape me right now. But there was even some Russell in here and Remington. But a lot of contemporary artists from, like, you know, the last 50 or more years. And James Ayers is in here. A-Y-E-R-S. Lots of good stuff. Lots of great art. Cool cover. So, $1. And it's like the book is in excellent shape. Okay, got some more. This one here, Creek Mary's Blood by D. Brown. A little bit of a stain over here, but the book itself is like in excellent shape. And I don't have this in soft cover or paperback. So hardcover, I think it was $1. And that's like supposed to be like an epic saga that D. Brown wrote a novel. Now this book here I have, but it was $2, and it's really nice. It's called Buckskin and Buffalo, The Artistry of the Plains Indians by Colin F. Taylor. And I'll just give you a little idea what's in here. Really great pictures, beautiful work Native Americans do, clothing, weapons. For $2, it was worth getting another one. They had such beautiful material culture. It's one thing about Native Americans, and I don't know anywhere else in history in the world where such beautiful material culture that people had. They're just wonderful craftsmen. The men and the women, especially the women with the beadwork and everything, just beautiful clothes they made. It's awesome. I like looking at the pictures. There's some interesting text, so that's something you kind of read maybe a few pages a night. Now this here, Great Detectives, A Century of the Best Mysteries from England and America, edited by David Willis McCullough. And this is like brand new condition. This was it $1? Yeah, I think it was $1 at the half price place. Thick book, lots of stories. You have in here Dorothy Sayers, G.K. Chesterton, Agatha Christie, William Faulkner, Dashiell Hammett, Raymond Chandler, Ellery Queen, Rex Stout, Ray Bradbury, Ed McBain, Donald Westlake, and others. There's more. So, pretty good buy. Let's see what else is here. America's Fascinating Indian Heritage, a Reader's Digest book, lots of pictures, pretty cool. Now this I have, but I wanted to get another one, Story of the Great American West. This is also a Reader's Digest book. Got lots of nice pictures in it, and, you know, interesting text, and it's in great shape with a dust jacket, and I think it was $1, so pretty good there. Excuse me a second. Okay, next, Bev Doolittle, New Magic. She's a very interesting artist. She does a lot of work that portrays Native Americans, but her art is I'm not sure what the word for it is, but she kind of like hides things in it. Like if you look at it, like she'll draw a forest, but there's like people in it, but you got to kind of like find them. Let's see here. This isn't one of those pictures where it's hard to find, but just to show you, can you see that? I don't know how well you could see it, but there's a lot of cool work, so that was worth $1. Now this next thing here, these three books came in a slipcase, which I have, and it's in brand new shape. All three books are in excellent shape. No names inside, nothing. Matter of fact, all the books I have that didn't have names inside. I got lucky today. So let me see here. We've got, these are hardcover. These, it's called, it's a Civil War series, and it's called Echoes of Glory. And then there's like, each book has an individual title. This one is Illustrated Atlas of the Civil War. This one is Arms and Equipment of the Confederacy. And again, they're brand new. And Arms and Equipment of the Union. And just let me get a look inside here. So, very cool. Let's see one more page here. Here's, I guess, battle flags. And excellent shape in the slipcase. And the last book is a Time Life book called The Rivermen. And this was a dollar. They had actually, I think, just about, if not the entire series from this. But a lot of them were not in great shape. They were like waterlogged. That's why I guess someone got rid of them. But this particular book is not waterlogged. And it was like brand new. So there you go. Let me see if I find one more pick. Oh, here's Yellowstone Kelly. He's a great one from the old days. Yellowstone Kelly. So that's what I picked up today. Again, I think it was 29 books. I did a quick count. And it only cost me $22. Less than a dollar a book. It's pretty good. That's because the paperbacks were a quarter each, which helped bring down the overall average. And the half-price sale certainly helped. So that's it for this video. And it's almost the end of the month. Actually, it's now past midnight. It's the 23rd. So in about another week, I'll be doing my end-of-month final video with what books I read this month and what movies I watched. And if I bought any other books, they'll be there too. So until then, bye-bye. So this is the last installment of October 2016 as I count down to retirement in June 2019. Started these videos in February 2016, so this is my 9th video. And I can't believe 9 months have gone by. It doesn't feel like it when you think about it. You know, it's a day-to-day existence. It seems like it takes forever, but boy, life really flies by. Can't believe this is the 9th video. Soon it'll be a year. That's amazing. So time is going. I don't want to rush my life by, but I do want my wife and I to reach that date of June 2019, the end of June, and be finished with work. That'd be nice. Live our lives doing what we want to do. At least that's the plan. Hopefully, health wise and everything, we're okay and can enjoy ourselves. So I'm going to finish up. I've been splicing these videos together. I used to do them all once at the end of the month, what I watched, what I've read, what books I purchased, and if you've been following along, which no one has, basically just as I go along throughout the month, I make little mini videos and put them together. So this is the last one for October. So the only thing I really bought since my last video, book-wise, by the way, I buy a lot of videos, DVDs, but I don't show those. I just, if I watch it, I tell that I watched it, but I'm not reviewing what I purchased in terms of DVDs. But the two books I bought, these were both used books at a used bookstore that I go to a lot near my job, and they're both in excellent condition. This one is called The Mountain Men. It was $2, and I actually have a copy of this in hardcover and softcover. But for $2, let me see if I can find a good picture in here. For $2, I'll get it. It's hard to turn away. If I ever have a bookstore, I have a lot of books that I could put up for sale, duplicates, but I'll probably never have a bookstore. I don't know. If I do, it won't be to sell the books I have. I love my books. But that would be cool to have a used bookstore, wouldn't it? That'd be a dream. Wow. Okay, so the next book I purchased is but what the duplicates, what I want to say with the duplicates, it would be nice that, you know, I helped have like a book room one day, get out of my apartment and have like a room with books, and then I could put out, you know, maybe on a coffee table, like some duplicates that I have, some hardcovers, and just, you know, it just looks nice. I think it says a lot about a person when you go into their place and you see what kind of books they have or don't have. It tells you a lot about the person, and I'd like to think that I'm a little bit above average with the books. Yes, it's a little bit conceited, but, you know, you like what you like, right? And you think what you like is good, and I do. Okay, Shooting Scripts. This is another book I purchased. It's actually funny. With this book, I wasn't going to get it. It's in good shape, but the corners, I fixed them up a little bit. It had a little stain on the side, which I got rid of, some light sandpaper. I figured maybe I could find a better copy that I wouldn't have to really do much with at all. Not that this was too much, come to think of it. But I was just being a little bit cheap. It was $2, and I thought, well, I'll go back to work, see how much it is on the internet, and I'll just get a better copy, because I never even heard of the book, but it looked interesting. I'll get to that in a second, what it's about. So anyway, I got back to work, and I looked it up on the internet, and it was selling for like over $35. Ridiculous. I mean, it was just there were no cheap copies. So I said, I better run back there right after work and see if it's still there. And I was pretty sure it would be. Not many people are going to be interested in it. So sure enough, there it was. I purchased it, and, you know, it's really not in bad shape. I should have just bought it right up front. I don't know what I was thinking. So this book is about basically Western writers and then movies that were made from their books. So it's got like Louis L'Amour in here, Norman A. Fox, Frank Gruber, Luke Short, Ernest Haycox, Marvin H. Albert, Claire Huffaka, and another chapter. Looks like it could be some other assorted authors. Maybe Will Henry's in there. I'm surprised there's not a chapter on Will Henry here. It's kind of surprising. But anyway, it looked really interesting, and looking forward to reading this one. Okay, then what books did I read for the month of October? So I don't know if last video that I mentioned that I was reading Baba Black Sheep, I probably mentioned it, and I finished it in the first few days of October. It was pretty good. It was actually a very, very good book. I was just a little bit disappointed in the author with some of the religion in there, although, you know, I could understand what the stress he was under, but he went on to really be more of a believer even after the war, thinking that, like, you know, God has like a purpose in his life. But, you know, I don't believe that. Even if there is a God, I don't believe it's involved in your life. There's just too many people, too many prayers. It's too many things. And I hope to make a video about this one day. I'm not going to do it right now. I write down a lot of thoughts I have, and I'm sure I'm not the first to have many of these thoughts. But, you know, I have my ideas. Everybody has their ideas, right? As long as you don't push your ideas on someone else, then we're all good. The problem is when people push their ideas, especially when they're looks like a myth, talks like a myth, sounds like a myth, and they want you to follow their myth. That's just not right. So, whatever. So, anyway, that book was a good book, though. I will say I did enjoy it. He had some extreme adventures, prisoner of war, fighter pilot during World War II. What was his name? Boyington. I forget his first name now, but his nickname was Pappy. And, of course, they had the TV show name escapes me. I'm very bad with that. I draw blanks. Robert Conrad, of course, played Boyington. And it was a pretty good show, but it looks like they left the religion part out of that show. But anyway, they even left the when he was captured out of the show. They just had, you know, the showing when he was the fighter pilot before he got captured. So I would actually recommend that book to read. And if you're religious, then, you know, all the better for you. But I'll be fair and say I did enjoy the book. So anyway, I also read James Welch, Winter in the Blood. This was Welch's first novel from 1974. It's the third one I've read by him. And the other two I enjoyed more. Not that this was bad. It wasn't bad at all. I just could have been better. It was a little bit mysterious. Some conversations take place that just you don't know what you're reading. It's like it's not consistent. It doesn't really give you details about why, like, you know, they're talking about A, and then all of a sudden someone says something completely different, B, and, like, what's the connection? I don't understand. It was just almost like you're on drugs and just things aren't connected. It was a little bit like that. Not that I would know firsthand, but really, I tried pot, like, 1980-something one time. I'm not a drug kind of guy. It just doesn't do it for me. But anyway, should I have said I did that on the internet? I don't know. Well, it's too late now. I made it up. I didn't do it. Actually, I remember who I was with and where I was, and it was kind of stupid now that I think about it. I'm not going to go into the details, but if I told you where I did it, you'd be like, that was crazy. Why'd you do that? I mean, if you're going to get caught, you don't want to do... sometimes, actually, maybe the safest place to commit a crime is where people will at least expect you to do it. Although, I don't know why smoking pot's illegal. I mean, it shouldn't be. And I didn't inhale. So, anyway, Winter in the Blood, James Welch. I was saying something about this book. I totally lost my train of thought. It must be the drugs. What was I saying? Oh, so the book, it's a little bit weird. I mean, there's even, like, there's one character in the book that's, like, white guy, because he writes about Native Americans, James Welch, and there's this white guy in the book, and he's, like, got some weird situation going on, and it's just, the whole thing is unclear, like, what he's doing, why he's doing it. You have to read it to see what I mean. Maybe there's some hidden meaning here. I don't get it. And I watched the DVD for this, which I'll get to in a little bit. And the DVD followed very closely to the book. And actually, I watched the movie first, and then I read the book. And I read the book thinking that, you know, I would learn more about what I just watched in the movie. But the truth is that the movie, for the most part, follows the book. Not completely, but for the most part, it does. And it didn't really give me any more insight reading the book. The movie was a bit odd, which I actually liked the movie more than the book. And again, it's not a bad book. It was a quick read. You can read this in about a week or less, depending on how much time you have, about 175 pages. So anyway, it was his first novel. He did get better, in my opinion, as from what I've read of the other two novels. I still have another two or three by him to read. But I like James Welch, and I recommend it. Even though I had it was a little bit awkward, the book, I thought. Okay, Hunter of Worlds, C.J. Cherry. I read a book by her, The Faded Sun, which I liked. For some reason, I'm having this flashback that I did this book already, but I don't think I did, because I read it in October. I swear I did. Well, anyway, here it is. If I did it before, I'm sorry, but I feel like I read this book this last month. Just having this weird flashback that I remember doing this already. It was pretty good. I'd give it, 3 out of 5 stars. Have some issues with it. Also had some issues with The Faded Sun, but that was a superior book, and actually it was 3 books in 1. The Faded Sun was published in 3 separate parts, then put out altogether as 1 big book. Not bad. Some good ideas, written in the late 1970s. I would assume that if this was written again today, like the same kind of book by her, that it might be a little bit better. Even though it's science fiction, I think that the more advanced we get in our science, the better a book a person can write regarding science fiction, because there's just more technology available that's real that you can work off of and expand upon. If that makes any sense. But it wasn't a bad book. It was good, and I still want to read more by her. So I wouldn't want to reread this book, but I definitely want to read more of her books. So that's a good sign. Next book is The Unidentified Woman, and this is by Mignon G. Eberhardt, a woman, mystery writer. The cover is kind of cool. the woman floating kind of like dead in the water. And I'll talk more about that in a moment when I review a DVD. So this book, quick read. You can read it in 5 to 10 days, depending on how much time you have. I would never read it again. I probably would get rid of it one day. But the cover's kind of cool. That's why I'm keeping it. I like the cover. It's a mystery novel. Takes place around 1941. It's supposed to be in Florida, I think, but the scenery, as described in the book, just didn't strike me as Florida. So I'm wondering if the person even understood what Florida looks like. The story itself was okay. I'm not going to get really into any details about it, but you could look it up online. So that's that with that book. I'm a big history buff, Native Americans, Indian Wars, and I read this book, Chief Joseph. It's a very plain cover. Chief Joseph, Yellow Wolf, and the Creation of Nez Perce History in the Pacific Northwest by Robert R. McCoy. A few quick words about this book. So, the Nez Perce War of 1877 is one of shameful events in American history. This book covers that a little bit, along with the Nez Perce Indians. What it's about is how historians in the past and writers, not even historians, but just whether they be explorers, missionaries, those evil missionaries, pushing their religion on other people, or just historians turn of the century between 18 and 19, you know, around 1900, more or less around that time frame, how they wrote books that were very, one-sided, Manifest Destiny, that the Indians, Native Americans, were in a way. They kind of, the victors wrote the history. So this book is kind of trying to even the score a little bit and point out, how the history was one-sided and trying to give both points of view. It's not that thick a book. Some people would think of some of this as politically correct history or revisionism, maybe. There were some good points in the book, some stuff I had issues with. There were some very good points, though. If you're interested in the Nez Perce Indians, definitely I would read this book. Everybody's going to get something different from it. What I had an issue with, you may not have an issue with. You may not even realize there was an issue to be had. You might think, what am I having an issue about with that? It's, everything is personal, subjective. So, not everything, but most things are, when you read a book, it's subjective. But I would recommend it. I'm keeping it. It was some worthwhile information in there. Okay, so now, movies that I watched. So first of all, let me just say that my family, my wife and my son and myself, we have Friday night at the movies, which we're doing for about a year. We just started it a few weeks ago. And then we still have Friday night movies that we watch. Or not really movies, we watch Farscape. We have Friday night Farscape. And but we're taking a break from that because we just finished maybe our second or third rewatch. I think as a family, that was our second rewatch. I've watched it more than that on my own. And I'm taking a break from it myself right now. And before we get back to that, we're doing Friday Night at the Movies. So this month in October, we watched two Abbott and Costello movies. We watched Abbott and Costello Meet Frankenstein and Abbott and Costello Meet the Mummy, which are on this pack of four movies here, DVD with four movies. And we still need to watch The Invisible Man and Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde over here. So in the coming month or two, we'll watch the other two of them. Those are always good, those Abbott and Costello movies. And my kid laughs a lot of the antics. Okay, then we watched The Gazebo. This is a movie I watched on my own last year sometime. And I think this is a great movie with Glenn Ford and Debbie Reynolds. And I'm not going to give away the plot. It's like part mystery, part part murder mystery, part comedy. I think it's excellent. I really like this movie. Glenn Ford was great in it. Then we watched Charade with Cary Grant and Audrey Hepburn. And my son liked this movie. This is a great movie. Really, if you haven't seen it, Charade. It's really very good. Okay, now, this isn't every movie that I watch. Some of them I downloaded from YouTube, like Powwow Highway. I don't have the DVD. They're selling it for too much money. I should have bought it, you know, years ago, but I just wasn't really buying movies then. But I'll find it one day. In the meantime, I downloaded it off of YouTube and watched it. Actually, come to think of it, that was my second time watching it. I watched it a few years ago also. So a few movies that I watch on YouTube, and they're not going to be in this, what I'm showing here. But of DVDs that I own, I watched The Chase with Robert Cummings, Peter Lorre, Michelle Morgan, and Steve Cochran. This was a pretty good movie. It's very true that, you know, I watched so many movies and I just can't remember all the details. I don't remember disliking it, but I remember that I felt somewhat cheated about something in the movie, like some issue about it, like towards the end, that they just kind of like changed things around. I'm like, what? And I remember like not taking to it too fondly. I don't remember what the details were anymore, but I like these old movies anyway. They're still fun to watch. So The Chase I watched. Dressed to Kill, Michael Shane mystery movie with Lloyd Nolan. I really like Lloyd Nolan as an actor, as a person. I don't know. From just a little detail that I know about him, not crazy about his political views. He was like pro prayer in school, and you know, you're allowed to pray in school. Just do it on your time. It shouldn't be like time set aside for prayer. And he was pro prayer in school, which I don't really understand what that means. I mean, I don't even know what to say about it. Like, did he want time set aside for school? This goes back to probably the 1950s or 60s that he spoke in favor of it. So I wonder how he would feel today if he was still alive. I don't know. But he was a great actor. I really enjoy him in this part. He was the guy for the part. Excellent. I enjoy him in those movies. This Gun for Hire. Alan Ladd and Veronica Lake. I liked it. Saying I like it doesn't mean I liked every single part of it, but I liked the movie. It was good. April Fool's, Jack Lemmon and Catherine Deneuve. This was really good. Started off great anyway. But overall, the movie was a good movie. Jack Lemmon was very good in it. Again, April Fool's. This I just watched last night, The Talk of the Town, with Cary Grant, Gene Autry, and Ronald Colman. This is pretty good. I'd put it on again. Not bad. Cary Grant plays an escaped killer, although he's not really the killer. And the movie is about how he tries to, you know, hide from the law and prove his innocence. So it was pretty good. The Night of the Hunter. Now, this is with Robert Mitchum is the main star. Shelley Winters is in it. She gets killed off early. Shouldn't have said that, right? Anyway, too late now. So, sorry if you didn't know about that. This movie has a lot of religion in it. And I guess, you know, if you're not religious, you can watch this movie and think, you know, look at it like, wow, the hypocrites, the hypocrisy of religion, it's all nonsense and bullshit. And if you are religious, you might look at it and say, oh no, this is pro-religion, and just the bad guy really isn't religious, he's just a faker and doesn't represent what I believe. But even the good religious people in this movie, they're just out of control with their religion, it just runs amok, and it affects the kids. I mean, they're pushing it on the kids in the movie. There's a scene in this movie where a woman is in the lake, dead, and she's like, the thing about it is the scene from that reminds me so much of this cover, of this woman in the ocean or a lake over here, kind of her hair is like flowing in the water, and she's just like, you know, just laying there at the bottom there, kind of floating along. There's a scene in the movie, in this movie, that's very reminiscent of that, and I wouldn't be surprised if that cover was made with this in mind, from this movie here. Robert Mitchum is excellent. There's a kid in the movie, Billy Chapin, I think is his name. So I looked him up. I think that was it. Billy Chapin, Chapin. He was excellent as the kid, this boy in the movie. This was I would recommend watching this movie, but the whole religion aspect is just kind of annoying. although I guess necessary for the movie, because it's almost like it's another character. Really good overall. Although, I gotta say, the movie's roughly an hour and a half. Let me see something here. I don't see running time, but it's roughly an hour and a half, 93 minutes. Okay, it's about an hour and a half. The first hour is really good. The last half hour, I thought the movie lost focus. Some of the main characters were no longer the main characters. And I just thought that it didn't, the last half hour didn't uphold the level of excellence of the first hour. That's my feeling, but it was still a good movie. There's a lot of extras on here too I need to watch. I think there's even a commentary on here. A lot of the movies I watch, they do have commentaries and bonus features, and I just don't have time to watch everything right now, so tons of stuff waiting for me. Okay, Paul Newman, The Drowning Pool. This was a good movie. He plays a detective based on a series of books by John McDonald. And there's another movie that he did. Now the name escapes me, but The Drowning Pool with Joanne Woodward, Tony Francioso. Not sure how you say it. But anyway, this was a really good detective movie. I liked it a lot. Newman was good. Indiscreet, Cary Grant and Ingrid Bergman. Overall, this movie was pretty good. It's not an action movie. It's a romance movie. I liked it. Once Upon a Time in the West. I've never seen this. The movie is 2 hours and 45 minutes. It's long, okay? It's long and drawn out. There's two ways to look at this movie, or more than two. One is it's like a art piece. You look at it, it's like the story takes its time. If you're really into filmmaking, and you're into just watching people not speak all the time, but just go about doing stuff. You know, sparse language throughout the film. I don't mean to say sparse language, but, you know, sparse dialogue. And you just like watching a long movie, and, you know, you love it. I thought it was good. I thought it was too long. Could have been cut, tightened up a bit, and that would have, you know, kept it. I don't know how to explain. It's like, you know, you can get tired watching this. You got to like really be awake and have some sugar nearby. So I did watch it. I had to take some breaks during it. Get up, stretch, have some lunch, build a house. You know, it's hard to sit through the whole thing all at one time. But it was good. I would watch it again for sure. But it is long and drawn out. But it has an excellent cast. I mean, it's just, I have mixed feelings about it, you know. On the one hand, it's great. On the other hand, it's just kind of long, and it's not always moving quickly. So it's just, you got to just be up and ready and prepared, and that's it. But it was good. Charles Bronson is in this, Henry Fonda, Jason Robards. It was good. So Sergio Leone made the film. So I'm just not going to say, I've watched YouTube videos, people reviewing this movie, and they're saying what a classic it is, it's the best Western, and, you know, just blabbering about it, and for the most part, 9 out of 10 reviews you will see will do that, and I'm not sure if they're jumping on the bandwagon or they really love it. I'm just saying that it is a really good movie, but it's long and drawn out, and it's not nonstop action, so you need to get up and stretch, I think, while you're watching it, and maybe watch it in two parts, you know, part Friday, part Saturday. but it is a good movie overall. Okay, Winter in the Blood. So I read the book after I watched the movie. I give the movie 5 stars. I thought it was excellent. I want to give kudos to the lead actor, whose name Chasky Spencer, and he's in a franchise of called Twilight, which I've never seen and have no interest in. but he was excellent in this. I thought he really played the character great. Again, based on a novel by James Welch, and it's a Native American movie, contemporary, kind of like Smoke Signals, Powwow Highway. I really like movies with Native Americans like that. They need to get more parts though in other movies, and maybe they, I don't really, you know, I'm not really up on current movies, so maybe they do get parts that I just don't see the movie, so I'm not aware of it, or I don't know the Native American because they're not playing a Native American in the movie. But I know from watching these movies with Native American actors that they're excellent, and this was a good movie. Again, for me, I thought it was a little bit better than the book, but it's kind of funny because if I had read the book first, would I think that the book was better than the movie? Maybe I have a fond memory of the movie because I saw it first. I don't know, but I do think that the movie version just edges out the book version. But I recommend them both, especially if you're gonna watch one or you know watch or. The movie you read the book, you should do the other also, just so you kind of get the full picture there. It Happened One Night, Clark Gable and Claudette Colbert. this was a pretty good movie. Overall, I enjoyed it. Clark Gable has like a, it's all said and done now, but a rape charge, an alleged rape charge against them. Who knows, you know, it was like some kind of date rape, I read. Hard to say, I don't know. But this was a good movie. This movie I enjoyed a lot, which surprised me. I never thought I would watch a movie like this. Cary Grant and Doris Day, That Touch of Mink, this is pretty good. This movie is not about religion, although the woman in it, Doris Day, seems like she's, like it's in her mind in a way, because she's not loose with herself, overly protective of her virginity, it seems, in the movie. That's the impression that I got, and maybe it was like a kind of religious hang-up. But it was a good movie, I got to say. I liked it. O.G. Meadows is in here from The Honeymooners. And this I would definitely watch again. There's more I wanted to say about it. It's not like a coming out, so I'm just going to let it go. But I liked it. The Narrow Margin. No people that I ever heard of before. Charles McGraw, Marie Windsor, Jacqueline White. I can only remember what the, I remember the lady on the back here looking at her now. I thought this was a pretty good movie. I don't remember much about it, but I remember liking it when I watched it. Wish I could say something about it, like, I don't remember all the details. I'm sorry, hold on 1 second. Read in the back, and maybe it'll come to me now. So, this is the one, just one where the man goes across country following a woman who went out west to California to be an actress or something. Am I boring you? I'm sorry. McGraw plays a cop guarding a gangster's mall fellow. Okay, forget what I just said about going west, California. I don't remember. I just don't remember. Doesn't matter. I don't really have bad memories of it, so narrow margin. Hey, I have reason to watch again because I don't remember. I'm sure once I put it on, I'll be like, oh, I remember this movie, but I just can't think of it right now. Now, this movie, I was very disappointed, and this is the last one I have for this video. The Rounders with Glenn Ford and Henry Fonda. Now, these are both great actors, and I like them, especially Glenn Ford. I really like him. And this movie was, I don't know what to say, boring? I mean, if you thought that Once Upon a Time in the West had slow parts, or, you know, just moved along and took its time. This was just silly. I don't even know. Was there a movie here? I'm not even sure. I'm going to keep it. Maybe one day I'll watch it again and feel different about it. Or it just makes good background noise. You don't have to think too much about it. But this was just a weird, silly, can't think of much reason why it was made movie. Maybe you feel different, or will feel different if you watch it. That's it for October 2016. So, over and out. I'll see you at the end of November or beginning of December. Actually, probably be around, I think December this year, December 3rd is a Friday. So I wait until like that night or Saturday night to make a video. I think December 3rd is a Friday. Maybe it's the 2nd. I don't know. But I'll make a video the end of beginning of December on a Friday or Saturday. So until then, bye-bye.